This is Bikini. It is here that the military and scientific personnel of Joint Task Force 1 will conduct the tests with the atomic bomb.
You've probably seen this footage. In 1946, the United States began testing nuclear bombs at the Marshall Islands in the Pacific. The military detonated a total of 67 nukes there over 12 years. And in the process, they irradiated local island residents, people involved in the testing, Japanese fishermen, and even the islands themselves. But that radiation is still causing problems today, decades later and far beyond the Marshall Islands. It's front page news thousands of miles away.
Some disturbing new revelations.
It's led to whistleblowers and angry government hearings.
Shame on y'all supervisors!
To a neighborhood that feels poisoned by the government. And to a case of ecological fraud that sent two people to prison so far.
And I can tell when people are lying to me. And you know what? My bullshit meter just went off.
This story takes place about 4,700 miles away from the Marshall Islands in San Francisco. The city today is in the grips of a housing crisis. The population is growing, land is at a premium, and new housing is desperately needed. And one of the biggest new developments is in an area called Bayview Hunters Point. It's a classic gentrification story, a brand new, expensive development built next to an established, lower-income, historically black community. It's also the site of radioactive waste, an alleged cover-up, and some criminal convictions. Less classic.
I mean, I couldn't believe it. I really couldn't.
Chris Roberts is a freelance reporter who works with The Verge's sibling site, Curbed. Chris has been reporting on this story since 2016, when people familiar with the Hunters Point development started telling him the same thing.
They said, look, you should really look into this. Things are bad, and they're worse than they've been reported.
The controversy stems from the land the development sits on. It's the site of a defunct naval shipyard at the edge of the Bayview Hunters Point community. Decades ago, the shipyard actually helped create the neighborhood.
People moved from all over the country to work at the shipyard, predominantly African-American people. During World War II, San Francisco's black population grew by 600%. Not only did the Navy transform Hunters Point transformed San Francisco.
The shipyard was shut down back in 1989, and soon after, city officials began eyeing it for housing. It's been slow going, but the Navy handed the first parcel of land over to the city in 2004. And in 2014, a handful of condos and townhomes hit the market under the name the San Francisco Shipyard. But there's a problem that goes all the way back to this. In 1946, the U.S. detonated a nuke underwater for the first time to see what would happen to a nearby fleet of abandoned ships. The target ships were so badly contaminated that officials later called them radioactive stoves that would have burned all living things aboard them with invisible and painless but deadly radiation. The solution, amazingly, was to tow some of those ships all the way to the Hunters Point shipyard. There, they went through a pretty messy decontamination process.
Which at the time was just a process of literally blasting the hulls and the decks with a mixture of sand.
There are different stories about what happened to the sand after that. But according to this massive Navy document, the sandblasting wastes were generally packed up and pitched into the sea. But some irradiated grit did settle elsewhere on the shipyard land. And that's just from the nuke tests. There was also radioactive paint left over from shipbuilding, contamination from fuels and pesticides, and radioactive materials used in lab experiments. And that's all on top of the asbestos that's just naturally in the soil there. It's a toxic place, and in 1989, the EPA added the shipyard to the Superfund list. Chris has been sniffing out documentation on all of this, some of which literally comes out of dusty boxes at the National Archives in San Bruno.
This is the first box of six that I'm working my way through. I will be here for most of the day now, today.
All of the issues surrounding Hunters Point, the nuclear legacy, the historic community, the development frenzy, they all build up to the present day and then collide. Cleaning up all that waste is a massive effort, and the government hired a firm called Tetra Tech EC to help. But a few years ago, whistleblowers started coming forward with claims of botched cleanup work by Tetra Tech.
A whistleblower is telling our investigative unit that he detected radiological contamination.
And reporters with NBC Bay Area got their hands on an internal Tetra Tech report that admitted Tetra Tech workers falsified soil tests. NBC called it an apparent effort to declare the soil free of radiological contamination when it may not have been. The scandal has only gotten worse from there.
Which really turns this case on its head.
This past May, two supervisors who worked for Tetra Tech were sentenced to prison time for falsifying soil tests. The whistleblowers, for their part, alleged that the fraud reached far beyond the two workers.
Back your office and get off my project.
The Navy reviewed Tetra Tech's work and initially found that about 30% of the sites they checked were suspect. The EPA did a review of their own, and their numbers were worse.
The EPA looked at the report that said, actually, we think it's closer to 95% to 97% of the work done by Tetra Tech can't be trusted.
The Navy told us that at this point, they're planning to check all of Tetra Tech's work.
Well, we're going back to resample 100% of the areas that they have worked on, and that's going to tell us, are these areas clean? Did we take care of the problem in 2014, or is there a lot more locations out there that need additional work?
We also talked to Tetra Tech's public relations person for the scandal, Sam Singer. He talked us in circles, put all the blame for the faked tests on those two supervisors, and denied just about everything else.
Okay, but remember, I get to give my, you get to ask questions, but I get to give my answers, okay?
That's the same answers every time.
Meanwhile, the people of San Francisco have not taken kindly to any of this. In May, the city's Board of Supervisors held a hearing to discuss the fiasco. The whistleblowers spoke their piece.
From the Navy, like, what the heck happened?
The public came out in force.
We need authority, autonomy, or at least equity.
And Tetra Tech's lawyer stormed out to jeers from the audience.
Bye-bye.
Hanging over all of this is a tricky question. How dangerous is the contamination at the shipyard? We talked to the Navy's technical liaison to the community, Catherine Higley. She heads up the School of Nuclear Science and Engineering at Oregon State University. She says that radiation risk depends on a few things: the type of radioactive material, where it is, and how much someone could be exposed to. She said that the amount of radioactive material found on the site is actually pretty low, and the Navy is confident that the community is safe. Of course, the scandal complicates those assurances, and it's put the new neighborhood in jeopardy. But there's also the old neighborhood to consider. The original Bayview Hunters Point community, which lost a major employer when the shipyard closed, and is now stuck next to an EPA Superfund site that was never fully cleaned up.
All of a sudden the shipyard closes. Now you're really paying attention, and the fathers are starting to get sick, and you don't know why. Mothers who worked in that shipyard are starting to get sick, and you don't know why.
Marie Harrison works with environmental advocacy group Green Action, and she was a longtime resident of the neighborhood before moving inland. She's watched the neighborhood struggle with a lot of health issues, higher than average asthma rates and problems with lung cancer and heart failure, to name just a few. For Marie, it feels inescapable.
In Bayview, almost every other person has asthma, cancer, or something going on.
The community has a lot more than the shipyard to worry about. It's still home to a wastewater treatment plant, nearby freeways, and lots of other heavy industrial usage. Connecting all those hazards to specific health problems can be tricky, but it's not hard to make some guesses.
We don't have to be engineers and scientists, because the one thing I can tell you for a fact is that we know what ails us.
So ultimately, the shipyard revelations just are not that novel. The discovery of fraud is vindicating, but it's not satisfying.
And they had to wait until the newspapers, reporters started to put it out there, whistleblowers. There was so much stuff that had piled up before they finally had to acknowledge that we were telling the truth.
For now, everyone involved is settling in for more rounds of testing, investigations, and legal battles. But it's hard to say if it will be enough. if the people there will ever really trust the officials who let them down in the first place.
I still don't trust you, and you have not made whole the wrongs that you've done back here. They're still lurking like a shadow in the dark.
There's a lot of history around nuclear weapons testing that we didn't get a chance to talk about in the video, but you can check out the documents yourself. We linked to them in the description, so take a look. It's incredible what's in there.